What about you, sir? Do you think the colored students will show up?
If I got anything to do with it, they won't show up. Well, I think it's a breaking point of the school integration. I just don't feel that they have a right to go to school.
Paul and Silas bound in jail. Had no money for to go to bail.
Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on, hold on.
Civil rights movement, a time of great change in American society. It was an era of violence and of hate, but also a dramatic time of transformation for African Americans living in the United States. Dramatic rulings from federal courts transformed the way the black community lived their normal lives. These changes in society, however, were more often than not challenged by white Southerners across the nation. Black Americans fought for justice and equality, and white segregationists fought back. It was, however, the strength and bravery of 9 young black individuals in a small town in Arkansas whose actions forever changed the movement for racial justice and equality in the United States. This is the Little Rock Nine.
It was the summer of 1957 in the small town of Little Rock, Arkansas, as 9 young individuals prepared for their first day of school. But in order to understand what had transpired that day, we must first go back 3 years. On May 17, 1954, the United States Supreme Court had finally made a ruling in the Brown v. Board of Education case. It ruled that racial segregation in public schools was unconstitutional and called on all public schools to integrate students of different races. When the ruling was announced, the Little Rock School Board agreed to comply with the ruling, as the superintendent Virgil Blossom drew up a plan to be enacted in September 1957.
The Blossom Plan, as it came to be known, however, became a very controversial plan that was developed to delay the effects of the Supreme Court ruling. Instead of immediate integration of black students all at once, the plan called for a slow initiative that would slowly incorporate black students over a long and undefined period of time. The plan also assigned black students to black schools, such as Horace Mann High School, even if those students lived far closer to the white school Little Rock Central High School. Even more shocking, the plan gave white students the option to not attend a Horace Mann, but it did not give African American students the option to attend Little Rock Central.
The Blossom Plan was criticized by many and it angered the NAACP, leading them to file a lawsuit against the Little Rock School District on February 8, 1956. After a number of legal proceedings, federal district courts finally ordered Central High School to follow through with the integration plan, and the school year began on September 4, 1957. Head of the Arkansas NAACP, Daisy Bates, selected 32 students to attend the first day of school based on grades and attendance, though many families decided not to participate in the integration. Of the 32 initially selected students, a group of students who eventually became known as the Little Rock Nine remained adamant in participating. Their names: Ernest Green, Elizabeth Eckford, Jefferson Thomas, Terrence Roberts, Coloda Wells, Minnie Jean Brown, Gloria Ray, Thelma Mothershed, and Melba Patillo.
The governor of Arkansas at the time, Orwell Favis, did not support the integration of black students. However, he didn't really care whether or not they were integrated. Favis, however, was fighting for re-election, and in order to gain the support of Southern Democratic segregationists, he needed to fight against the integration of African-American students in Central High. On the first day of school, Favis ordered the Arkansas National Guard to guard Central High, citing fear of imminent danger of tumult, riot, and breach of peace, and the doing of violence to persons and property, though he really only called upon the guard to gain the support of Southern Democrats.
Elizabeth Eckford was the first to arrive that morning and was immediately met with National Guard troopers. She was denied entrance to the school by the National Guard and was then met by an angry white mob while waiting for the bus home. Many called her racial epithets, spat on her face, and screamed for her to be lynched. Elizabeth recalls, "They moved closer and closer. Somebody started yelling. I tried to see a friendly face somewhere in the crowd, someone who maybe could help. I looked into the face of an old woman and it seemed a kind face, but when I looked at her again, she spat on me." Fortunately, she was safely escorted onto the bus before the hatred escalated. The other 8 students arrived together later that morning, but in similar fashion to Elizabeth, they were also turned away by the National Guard.
With the help of the NAACP and Daisy Bates, A judge later approved the return of the students later that month on September 23rd. The angry white crowd grew to the thousands by the time it came for the students to return, though Favis withdrew the National Guard the day before, leaving no one to protect the children. With no one to control the angry crowd, the mob attacked and brutally assaulted four black reporters at the school that they assumed were the parents of the Little Rock Nine on the day of the students' return. The Nine were able to enter the school, though their stay was only temporary, as the crowd grew more violent and broke through barricades and windows, forcing the students to leave in fear of their own safety.
The media coverage was incredible. The whole event was broadcasted on televisions across the nation, and stories were written in newspapers about what had occurred in Little Rock, gaining the attention of President Eisenhower. Eisenhower did not support segregation, but he also did not support the efforts of the civil rights movement. The national controversy essentially pressured Eisenhower into taking action in Little Rock. On September 24th, he ordered the 101st Airborne Division of the United States Army to go to Little Rock and take control of the Arkansas National Guard from Favis. At last, with the protection of escorts from the National Guard, the students were finally able to attend their first day of school on the following day.
Despite their small win, the Nine had to endure an incredibly difficult remainder of the year. The National Guard remained stationed at Central High for the rest of the year. The troops were gradually reduced until May 8, 1958, when the last of the National Guard troops left. The young men and women became the targets of racially driven hate crimes by the white population of Central High. The Nine were physically abused and emotionally tormented. At one point, one of the Nine, Mabel Patillo, had acid thrown in her eyes by a white student. She was also almost burned alive when a group of girls trapped her in one of the stalls in the bathroom and then threw flaming pieces of paper on her.
Another one of the Nine, Minnie Jean Brown, was one day taunted by a group of young boys in the cafeteria. In response, she dropped her bowl of chili on their heads and was given a 6-day suspension. After more and more incidents of confrontation, Minnie Jean was eventually suspended for the entire year and was forced to spend the rest of the year at New Lincoln High School in New York City. She recalled, "I was one of the kids approved by the school officials. We were told we would have to take a lot and were warned not to fight back if anything happened." The white students that committed the crimes were only punished if the incidents were witnessed by an adult. In addition, Favis further tried to delay the integration of more black students, and in September of 1958, he signed acts to shut down all public schools in the district. All the schools officially closed on September 15th. The black community was subsequently attacked and blamed for the closing of the schools, which became known as a lost year. The schools were then finally reopened on August 12, 1959.
To this day, Central High School remains as an active school within the Little Rock School District. One of the members of the Nine, Mabel Patillo, has also written a memoir titled Warriors Don't Cry, about her experiences at the time of the Little Rock Crisis. The Little Rock Nine were also presented the Congressional Gold Medal by Bill Clinton in 1999. In 2007, the United States Mint also developed a commemorative silver dollar coin to recognize and pay tribute to the strength, the determination, and the courage displayed by African American high school students in the fall of 1957. It is quite apparent that the Little Rock Nine left behind quite a remarkable legacy in American history. The crisis that occurred in Little Rock remains a powerful and inspiring example of resistance against what is wrong, and the promotion of equality and justice for all races. In the current era of the racial turmoil of today, we must look at the story of these nine incredibly brave souls as models for social change and apply that same resolve and determination to further change and better our own society.